Over the past several months, we've taken you on a journey through geologic history, one era at a time. If you haven't been on that trip with us yet, those videos, they're all down in a playlist below. And by now, you're probably tired of hearing us tell you that you're related to all of these bizarre organisms that look nothing like you. Like in the Mesozoic era, we introduced you to the Megazostrodon, a little insectivore that lived among the dinosaurs as one of the earliest known mammals. At least that's a mammal, so you can see the connection, right? But what about Dimetrodon? It lived in the era before the Mesozoic, in the Paleozoic. It's not our direct ancestor, but it was a stem mammal, part of the group of animals that descended from reptiles to give rise to mammals. And when you look at it, well, it's not exactly like looking in a mirror, is it? By the time we follow our lineage back even farther to Leica, the ancestor of all eukaryotes, and Leuca, the single-celled ancestor of everything that's alive today, we're talking about forms of life whose lives and structures we can only speculate about. But now you have arrived at the Cenozoic era, and in fact, you've always been there, because that's the era that we're in now. And the Cenozoic is when many organisms took shapes and behaviors that you can actually recognize. Most of the mammals and birds that you can think of appeared during this era, and reptiles went through some surprising changes, but they eventually settled into the ranges that they inhabit today. But perhaps more importantly, for us at least, the Cenozoic marks the rise of organisms that look a lot like you and me. Okay, to be fair, if you had traveled back to the start of the Cenozoic era 66 million years ago, there would still be a lot that you would not recognize. It was so warm that the whole world was full of tropical and subtropical forests, even at the poles. And for about the first 10 million years of the Cenozoic, the world was still recovering from the KPG extinction event that wiped out the non-avian dinosaurs. That was the very beginning of the Paleogene period, and the world was kinda empty. Along with the dinosaurs, almost all other large land vertebrates had vanished. Many terrestrial plants were gone too, and in the oceans, the giant marine reptiles and even most of the plankton had disappeared. Because of this scarcity of life, during this first chapter of this period, known as the Paleocene epoch, there were plenty of open ecological niches, and the surviving forms of life began to fill them. The last remaining dinosaurs, birds, had begun to diversify into some pretty familiar forms. For example, around this time we begin to see the likes of Waimanu, a small, flightless water bird from New Zealand that's one of the earliest known penguins. Likewise, in New Mexico, the appearance of Sidiazi tells us that the ancestors of mouse birds found today all over sub-Saharan Africa were already on the scene. Meanwhile, on the forest floor, some early ungulate-like mammals began to take over. At first, these mammals had it pretty easy because there weren't many predators, but plenty of insectivorous mammals had survived the extinction, and it didn't take long for some of them to start developing a taste for bigger prey. These were the creodonts, predators that first appeared in North America, like the small dog-like Galesion, as well as Oxiana, which looked more like a cat. For a long time, scientists thought that these small meat-eaters were the direct ancestors of today's modern carnivores. But in recent years, we've learned that they actually are a separate lineage, one that only happened to converge on the same strategies and overall body plan of the carnivores we know today. Now, other mammals made their homes in the trees, including some of the first primate-like species, the plesiadapiforms. They first showed up in Europe and North America, and even though most researchers think they weren't direct ancestors of primates, they can still tell us a lot about what the earliest primates might have looked like. Purgatorius, for example, looks a lot like a rat, but it had long, grasping fingers useful for life in the trees, and wide teeth for chewing things like fruits and leaves. But like other plesiadapiforms, Purgatorius had claws instead of nails, and it was missing one of the key features of a true primate. Its eyes didn't face forward. So by the middle of the Paleocene epoch, animal life was on the rebound. And then it started to get really warm. Around 55 million years ago, the average temperature on land went up by 5 to 8 degrees Celsius in less than 20,000 years. This spate of global warming marks the transition to the next epoch, the Eocene, and it's known as the Paleocene-Eocene Thermal Maximum, or PETM. Remember this one. If you've seen our episode on this phenomenon already, then you know that we're not totally sure what caused it. It might have had to do with volcanic eruptions or melting methane ice on the ocean floor that released greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. Either way, as a result, a world that was already warmer than today's world started to get even hotter. At the poles, lush ecosystems took hold while parts of Western North America became arid. This was great for animals that thrived in the heat, like reptiles. How great? Well, this is when the world saw the biggest snake that ever lived. Titanoboa slithered through Southern America during during this hot spell, all 13 meters of it, about twice the size of a modern anaconda. It feasted on fish, but also crocodiles, and also anything else it could get its jaws around, which was most things. Also in the water were reptiles like the giant turtle Carbonemes, which, unlike our shelled friends that we know and love today, were about 3 meters long and fed on mammals and other reptiles. While all this was going on, some of the first true primates were appearing. The tiny Omamiids, for example, had grasping fingers with nails instead of claws, and giant eyes like tarsiers. Then, about 49 million years ago, this warming trend shifted, and the world began its long journey from a greenhouse to an ice house. This shift may have been caused at least in part by what's known as the azolla event, where massive amounts of this small moss-like azolla fern grew in the Arctic. These plants took up half of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, enough that the climate began to cool. And a lot of mammals from the Paleocene couldn't handle the cooler, drier weather of the late Eocene, so by about 40 million years ago, many of them had gone extinct. At least 45 groups disappeared from Asia, like the Eurymylids, a family thought to be closely related to early rodents. In North America and Europe, the changing forests caused problems for mammals that lived in the trees, including primates. By the late Eocene, practically all of the primates on those continents died out. But at the same time, some modern mammal groups start to show up in the fossil record, like familiar rodents and the odd-toed ungulates, the group that includes today's horses, rhinos, and tapirs. And it's in the late Eocene that some of the simians, the clade that includes monkeys and apes, began to appear in the fossil record. By the time the next epoch, the Oligocene, begins around 34 million years ago, we start to see the likes of Egyptopithecus in northern Africa, an early member of the group that includes what are known as the Old World monkeys, and eventually the apes. But now the global temperature was taking an even steeper plunge, with ice sheets beginning to form in Antarctica. And soon, another extinction event began, this one mostly in Europe. It's known as the Grande Coupure, and like most other extinctions, we haven't figured out all the details of what caused it. But we know the drop in temperature would have made it hard for some of the older groups of mammals to survive. It might have also lowered sea levels enough to allow more migration from Asia, and therefore more competition. Almost all of the tree-dwelling European mammals were wiped out, and all kinds of new creatures moved in, like true carnivores and artiodactyls, the group of ungulates that included animals like today's pigs, deer, and cattle. Then, in the cooler, drier climate of the Oligocene, a new habitat appeared. Grassland. And this was an enormous deal, because the fibrous grass was harder to digest than the softer vegetation like leaves, which meant that animals had to adapt or die. Among the herbivores, the even-toed ungulates known as ruminants had the advantage because they had an extra stomach chamber where grass could be fermented and partly digested, then sent back to the mouth to be chewed again. In the late Oligocene, there was also a major split among the simians. Around 26 million years ago, the first so-called New World monkeys appear in the fossil record in South America. We're not really sure how they got there, although the lower sea levels might have helped them get around. These New World monkeys retained a lot of the traits of earlier monkeys, like their small size and fruit-based diet. Meanwhile, the larger Old World monkeys in Africa and Asia began to take a different route. Many of these Old World monkeys had a broader diet, and some started to spend more of their lives on the ground. Now, the transition from the Paleogene to the next period of the Cenozoic, the Neogene, is a subtle one, usually recognized by changes in microscopic fossils of things like algae and foraminifera. But the events that unfolded during this period, starting 23 million years ago, were hard to miss. The Neogene opened with the Miocene epoch, as continental plates were on the move, kicking off an era of mountain building that continues today. The Himalayas were forming as the Indian plate rammed into Asia, while collisions in Europe started to create the Pyrenees and the Alps. Meanwhile, in Africa, another transition was underway as the first apes evolved from the Old World monkeys. We're not completely sure what the first ape was, but a transitional genus called Proconsul first appeared around the start of the Neogene that may have been close to the start of the ape lineage. The most obvious trait of these animals was their lack of a tail, but they also had more flexible shoulder joints, broad, flat rib cages, and a shorter spine. Among other things, these traits combined to make it easier for apes to swing from the trees and eventually to balance on two legs. For the most part, the rest of the Miocene continued continued the trends that began in the Oligocene. As the world continued to cool, forests began to shrink while grasslands spread. For animals that grazed instead of browsing on trees, they had vast new expanses to disperse to. But almost all of the herbivores that couldn't survive on grass, like browsing horses, began to disappear. In the oceans, the bizarre marine mammals like Desmostylia had disappeared, but new forms of life started showing up in the fossil record, like sea otters and other animals that made their homes in the world's first kelp forests. And in the meantime, apes continued to diversify. In the next few million years, the ancestors of each of the great apes split off from the ancestors of humans. The ancestors of orangutans diverged from our lineage about 13 million years ago, the ancestors of gorillas were next around 10 million years ago, followed by the ancestors of chimpanzees and bonobos around 7 million years ago. By the time the Miocene ended 5.33 million years ago, the lineage that would lead to humans was established. In fact, most of the groups of animals around the world today had evolved. The world was getting closer to something we would truly recognize. Sure, there was the occasional gomphotheer or three-toed horse, but other groups like canids, bears, and whales were fully fledged. The transition to the next epoch, the Pliocene, involved a brief period of warming, followed by an even faster drop in temperature. South America, which had detached from Antarctica in the Oligocene, finally bumped into North America, cutting off the Atlantic Ocean from the warm currents circling the equator. And as the climate continued to cool, our ancestors, the hominins, were taking over the expanding grasslands. The first known hominins, Australopithecus, appear in the fossil record around 4 million years ago. Researchers think some of these early hominins were actually able to digest grass, which would have made it easier for them to find food no matter what the climate was. Over time, they became better runners and more skilled hunters. And there's evidence that toward the end of the Pliocene, they had begun using stone tools. By 2.8 million years ago, just a couple hundred thousand years before the end of the epoch, a new genus, Homo, appeared on the scene in the form of a lower mandible found in Ethiopia known as the Ledi jaw. The end of the Pliocene also marked the end of the Neogene and the start of our current period of the Cenozoic, the Quaternary, about 2.5 million years ago. And this most recent chapter in the history of life is so packed with crucial developments, from the last ice age to the rise of the spread of Homo sapiens, that we will handle them all in a separate episode. But by now you've seen how the events of the Cenozoic truly shaped our world and us. It began with a world recovering from extinction with millions of niches for mammals to fill, and it peaked with a warming event that helped spur the rise of the primates. Yes, you might not be the spitting image of Egyptopithecus, but the Cenozoic era was when the world as we know it came to be. More than any other era in history, it is our time. Thanks for watching me today. Now, what do you want to know about the story of life on Earth? Let us know in the comments, and don't forget to go to youtube.com/eons to subscribe. As part of us trying to give you things with which to support this show, Eons has developed a really kind of beautiful piece of art in the form of a poster that is now available at dftba.com. I've got mine. Did you get yours?